Today is Transfiguration Sunday, and this marks the end of the season of Epiphany, the season of light, and that means that this coming Wednesday is Ash Wednesday, which begins our journey through Lent. I invite you to turn to our brief order for confession and forgiveness. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, whose voice is upon the waters, whose mercy is poured out upon all people, whose goodness cascades over all creation. Amen. Let us confess our sin, trusting in the abundant grace of God. Holy God, you search us and know us. We are acquainted with all our ways. We confess that our hearts are burdened by sin, our own sins, and the broken systems that bind us. We turn inward, failing to follow your outward way of love. We distrust those who are not like us. We exploit the earth and its resources, and fail to consider generations to come. Forgive us, gracious God, for all we have done and left undone. Even before the words are on our tongues, you know them. Receive them in your divine mercy. Amen. How vast is God's grace! Through the power and promise of Christ Jesus, our sins are washed away, and we are claimed as God's own beloved. In the wake of God's forgiveness, we are called to be the beloved community, living out Christ's justice and the Spirit's reconciling peace. Amen. We are not quite yet able to sing out our hymns. Hopefully that will come soon. So we are going to read aloud the verses of our hymn for today, Jesus on the Mountain Peak. Jesus on the mountain peak stands alone in glory blazing. Let us, if we dare to speak, join the saints and angels praising. Alleluia. Trembling at his feet, we saw Moses and Elijah speaking. All the prophets and the law shout through them their joyful greeting. Alleluia. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us join in praying our prayer of the day. Almighty God, on the mountain you showed your glory in the transfiguration of your Son. Give us vision to see beyond the turmoil of our world, and to behold the King in all his glory. Through your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. We turn to our readings. Our first lesson is from 2 Kings in the second chapter. And today's reading centers on the transfer of power and authority from the prophet Elijah to Elisha. Their travels, which retrace the path of Joshua back to Moab, the place where Moses died, and the parting of the waters, demonstrate that Elisha and Elijah are legitimate successors of the great prophet Moses. Now, when the Lord was about to take Elijah up to heaven by a whirlwind, Elijah and Elisha were on their way from Gilgal. Elijah said to Elisha, "Stay here, for the Lord has sent me as far as Bethel." But Elisha said, "As the Lord lives, and as you yourself live, I will not leave you." So they went down to Bethel. The company of prophets who were in Bethel came out to Elisha and said to him, "Do you know that today the Lord will take your master away from you?" And he said, "Yes, I know. Keep silent." Elijah said to him, "Elisha, stay here, for the Lord has sent me to Jericho." But he says, "As the Lord lives, and as you yourself live, I will not leave you." So they came to Jericho. And the company of prophets who were at Jericho drew near to Elisha and said to him, "Do you know that today the Lord will take your master away from you?" And he answered, "Yes, I know. Be silent." And Elijah said to him, "Stay here, for the Lord has sent me to the Jordan." But he said, "As the Lord lives, and as you yourself live, I will not leave you." So the two of them went on. 50 men of the company of prophets also went and stood at some distance from them, for they both were standing by the Jordan. Then Elijah took up his mantle and rolled it up and struck the water. The water was parted to one side and to the other until the two of them crossed on dry land. When they had crossed, Elijah said to Elisha, "Tell me what I may do for you before I am taken from you." Elisha said, "Please, let me inherit a double share of your spirit." He responded, You have asked a hard thing. Yet if you see me as I am being taken from you, it will be granted you. If not, it will not." As they continued walking and talking, a chariot of fire and horses of fire separated the two of them, and Elijah ascended in a whirlwind into Elisha kept watching and crying out, "Father, Father, the chariots of Israel and its horsemen." But when he could no longer see him, he grasped Here ends the reading.
Let's join in reading responsibly our psalm number 50. The Lord, the God of gods, has spoken. He has called the earth from the rising of the sun to its setting. Out of Zion, perfect in its beauty, God reveals himself in glory. Our God will come and will not keep silence. Before him there is a consuming flame, and round about him a raging storm. He calls the heavens and the earth from above to witness the judgment of his people. Gather before me my loyal followers, those who have made a covenant with me and sealed it with sacrifice. Let the heavens declare the righteousness of his cause, for God himself is judge. Our second lesson comes from the second letter to the Corinthians in the fourth chapter. The spotlight of Christian ministry is not on the people who carry out ministry, but on the Lord Jesus Christ. Just as God made light shine at creation, God makes the light of Jesus shine in our lives through Christian ministry. Even if our gospel is veiled, it is veiled to those who are perishing. In their case, the God of this world has blinded the minds of the unbelievers to keep them from seeing the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ, who is the image of God. For we do not proclaim ourselves. We proclaim Jesus Christ as Lord, and ourselves as your slaves for Jesus' sake. For it is the God who said, "Let light shine out of darkness," who has shown in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. Here ends our reading. Please join with me in reading aloud our gospel verse. Alleluia. Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life.
Alleluia.
The Holy Gospel according to St. Mark in the ninth chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Mark's Gospel presents the Transfiguration as a preview of what would become apparent to Jesus' followers after he rose from the dead. Confused disciples are given a vision of God's glory manifest to the beloved Son. 6 days later, Jesus took with him Peter, James, and John, and led them up a high mountain apart by themselves. And he was transfigured before them, and his clothes became dazzling white, such as no one on earth could bleach them. And there appeared to them Elijah with Moses, who were talking with Jesus. Then Peter said to Jesus, "Rabbi, it is good for us to be here. Let us make three dwellings, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." He did not know what to say, for they were terrified. Then a cloud overshadowed them, and from the cloud there came a voice. "This is my Son, the Beloved. Listen to him." Suddenly, when they looked around, they saw no one with them anymore, but only Jesus. As they were coming down the mountain, he ordered them to tell no one about what they had seen until the Son of Man had risen from the dead. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, our Rock and Redeemer. Amen. So here we are, Transfiguration Sunday. And at the cusp of beginning our season of Lent, we are going from the pinnacle of light, of dazzling white, of an amazing moment on top of the mountain, and then we will be making that switch to journey down the mountainside and to take the journey with Jesus that leads to Jerusalem.
we pause here on the mountain. We pause here with the disciples in this beautiful moment and enjoy and celebrate the gift of light that is our Savior. In our second lesson, in that last verse, verse 6, "For it is the God who said, 'Let light shine out of darkness,' who has shown in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ." Let light shine out of darkness. This has been the business of our God and the business of our Savior, to let light shine out of the darkness. From the very beginning in creation, when the chaos was separated and creation began to be formed, "Let there be light." And there was light, and it was good. And from those very beginnings, we see again and again how God sought to share his light, his grace, his life with the people. We get a little of that in our first lesson with that dramatic coming of Elijah into heaven, where he is turning his power over to Elisha, and he himself will be carried up. We see that light, that work of God, through all those prophets, and throughout all those figures like Moses, throughout the Old Testament. And when we come to the New Testament, we come to the greatest light being revealed in our Savior. Let the light shine out of darkness, so we might know the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. So that is God's business, and therefore that is our business, letting the light of God shine so that we might have the knowledge of the glory of God in Jesus Christ. We are in the business of light. That's one of the reasons why we light candles. And that's another reason why at the baptism today of little Monroe, we will have a candle for her. And we will light that and say, "Let your light so shine before others that they may see your good works and glorify your Father in heaven. Let your light shine." And it is in those kinds of moments that God's light shines on us. And we have that same opportunity to shine that light back to the world around us. Some of those ways are a little more obvious and lovely, like when we get Monroe good and wet this morning. We're not sure what she's going to think. There might be yelling. She just might look at me like I'm crazy. She might sleep through it. We don't know. But that is a moment of light. God's giving light to us, for us to see Jesus Christ, to see God in action, sharing that gift of grace and forgiveness. But those times of light come in other places in our lives as well. I want you to think about those times when you have needed that encouragement, or you have been given a moment of inspiration, when that light has shined on you. Sometimes those moments are traumatic, like those disciples up on that mountaintop and Jesus dazzling white. That's pretty darn dramatic. And some are more in the simple ways and days of life. But we are asked to keep our hearts and our minds and our eyes and our ears open to recognize the ways that God is at work, the way God seeks to share that light, so that we in turn can be light bearers as well. There was one time when I was in the grocery store in my first call. I was in a rush. I had to get stuff for supper. I was not, in the mood to chat. I needed to hurry up and grab something and go. And I was in the produce section. I don't know why, but I remember that very well. I was in the produce section and came across a woman who was just looking so very sad and so very down and discouraged. And so myself to be open to this moment, I realized that this was a moment that God was shining light on me and on this woman. This was a moment of God's shining light, of Jesus being right there in that moment. As God slowed me down and had me open my eyes to recognize what he's up to, and as that light that I've been giving, I sought to share with this woman who was struggling, who was in the grocery store, and for the first time, she was buying groceries for one, not for two. And in that produce section, God's light shined. Actually, I've had a number of experiences in the grocery store. I don't know why. And usually when I'm in a hurry. But I want you to examine and recognize those moments in your lives when you have been given that gift, when you have been given that encouragement or that presence and that awareness, what a gift that is to you to receive that light. And then for us to be aware and able to shine, to turn that light and shine it on others, to have that awareness. Instead of having our blinders on and just focused on our lives and our loved ones, we have to get done. I wanted to make gross that night. I needed to gross. Instead, asking God to remove those blinders from us so that we can look at the world around us and recognize that there are so many opportunities for us to share that light. That light can be shown in some of our ladies who have made it their work to make masks to be shared with our clinics and hospitals and others. That light can be shown when you take the time to greet someone and treat them as a human being. I think about, whenever we go to Walmart, I think about those poor employees. How so often they're treated so terribly. And it can be instead be moments of light for them, light and grace. And for each other, words of encouragement, words of hope, just like we need that as well. It would be wonderful for us to be able to stay on the mountain peak. It would be lovely for us to stay at that moment of dazzling light, of excitement and joy, and God's presence so fully there. And so Peter asks about making stations, booths, for Jesus and Elijah and Moses. Let's stay here. Let's stay here in this wonder. But of course, that's not how life works. Instead, Jesus turns his face to go down the mountain and to face all those things that need to happen and need to be done. Even the darkest of moments and the greatest of pain, so that God's light may emerge triumphant over all darkness, even the darkness of death. So I invite you to enjoy the light, bathe yourselves in it, glory in the light of God and the gift that that is for you, and that gift that may be worked through you. And then I invite you to prepare yourselves then for Wednesday, when once again we may receive those ashes on our forehead and we are reminded that we are from dust, and to dust we shall return. To recognize that there is no darkness, there is nothing that can separate us in the end from the light of Christ. Amen. We have two more verses of our hymn to read aloud. Swift the cloud of glory came, God proclaiming in its thunder, Jesus as the Son by name. Nations cry aloud in wonder.
Hallelujah.
This is God's beloved Son.
God, the prophets sing before him.
everybody parked out there, I want to make sure they can hear this as well. Especially because now we have come to the baptism part of our morning. So I'm going to invite Monroe and her family to come on up. Yay! We're not going to let anything, even COVID, stop us from this gift of grace. Hey, sweetheart. And it is fun when they're a little older because they can just check it all out. What do you think?
We'll see. All right. And you can follow along on our PowerPoint or in our green book. In holy baptism, our gracious Heavenly Father liberates from us from sin and death by joining us to the death and resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. We are born children of a fallen humanity. In the waters of baptism, we are reborn children of God and inheritors of eternal life. By water and the Holy Spirit, we are made members of the church, which is the body of Christ. As we live with him and with his people, we grow in faith, love, and obedience to the will of God. In Christian love, Mom and Dad, you have presented Monroe for holy baptism. You should therefore faithfully bring her to the services of God's house and teach her the Lord's Prayer, the Creed, and the Ten Commandments. As she grows in years, you should place in her hands the Holy Scriptures and provide Christian faith that living in the covenant of their baptism and in communion with the church, she may lead a godly life until the day of Jesus Christ. Do you promise to fulfill these obligations? If so, I do.
Thank you.
Sponsors! Do you promise to nurture Monroe in your Christian faith as you are empowered by God's Spirit to the covenant of baptism and communion with the church? Oh, please answer, I do. People of God, do you promise to support Monroe and pray for her in her new life in Christ?
We do.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
All right, I'm going to do the water prayer. Can I have one of you young men come up and help me? Now, when I give you the signal, would you please pour this water into this bowl?
Yes.
Amen. Holy God, mighty Lord, gracious Father, we give you thanks for in the beginning your Spirit moved over the waters and you created heaven and earth. By the gift of water, you nourish and sustain us and all living things. By the waters of the flood, you condemned the wicked and saved those whom you have chosen, Noah and his family. You led Israel by a pillar of cloud and fire through the sea, out of slavery into the freedom of the promised land. In the waters of the Jordan, your son was baptized and anointed with the Spirit. All right, you ready? All right, let's start pouring. By the baptism of his own death and resurrection, your beloved son has set us free from the bondage to sin and death, and has opened the way to the joy and freedom of everlasting life. He made water a sign of the kingdom and of cleansing and rebirth. In obedience to his command, we made disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Pour out your Holy Spirit that those who are baptized may be given new life. Wash away the sin of all those who are cleansed by this water, and bring them forth as inheritors of your glorious kingdom. Praise and honor and worship to your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, in the unity of the Holy Spirit. Forever. Amen. All right.
in the confession of our creed. Do you believe in God the Father?
I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth.
Do you believe in Jesus Christ, the Son of God?
I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead.
Do you believe in God the Holy Spirit?
No.
I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Thank you. All right. It's time. Let's see what you think. You hold her. Hold the water. Let me know whether or not I got to do the water. Oh, here we go, button. And the Son. And the Holy Spirit. You probably got her straight with it, right? Well, I'm glad she likes the experience. God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, we give you thanks for freeing your sons and daughters from the power of sin and for raising them up to a new life in these holy sacraments. Pour your Holy Spirit upon them all, the Spirit of wisdom and understanding, the Spirit of counsel and might, the Spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord, the Spirit of joy in your presence.
Amen.
Monroe, child of God, you have been sealed by the Holy Spirit and marked with the cross of Christ forever. I think she'd like to just jump down in that water again. Let your light so shine before others that they may see your good works and glorify your Father in heaven. We give you this candle as a way to remind you of Christ's light in her life. And we invite you to light this candle on her baptismal birthday or on her birthday as a way to remind you and all that she is God's child. You know that for me? Through baptism, God has made Monroe a new sister and a member of the priesthood we all share in Christ Jesus, that we may proclaim the praise of God and bear his creative and redeeming word to all the world.
We welcome you into the Lord's family. We receive you as a fellow member of the body of Christ, child of the same heavenly Father, and worker with us in the kingdom of God.
Well, it's such a pleasure to get to do this with you and your family and to officially welcome Monroe. Normally this is the time I get older. We go shore off. Someday. I have the certificate of holy baptism and the box for the candle. Also, we give out this book, Water Come Down, the day you were baptized, for you to share with her as she grows, to help her know that she is God's. Well, let's welcome our new sister. Thank you very much. And this is quite damp. Somebody had a
faith far and near, for all who show the face of Christ throughout the world, and for our new sister in Christ, Monroe. Let us pray.
Have mercy, O God.
For creation, sun, moon, and stars, life forming in the dark earth and ocean deep, mountains, clouds, and storms, and creatures seen and unseen, and for the Holy Spirit's guidance in our stewardship of God's creation, let us pray.
Have mercy, O God.
For those responsible for safety and protection, for emergency responders and security guards, attorneys and advocates, civil servants and leaders of governments, that they witness to mercy and justice throughout the world, let us pray.
Have mercy, O God.
For all who suffer this day, praying especially for Connie, Cheryl, Arlen, Eileen, Faye, Steve, Gary, Helen, Muriel, Lorelai, Terry, Linda, Roger, Doug, Cheryl, Ricky, Marsha, Mary, Brad, and all those whose names you read in our hearts, that Christ our healer transforms sickness into health, loneliness into companionship, bereavement into consolation, and suffering into peace, let us pray.
Have mercy, O God.
For companions on life's journey in this worshiping community, for loved ones who cannot be with us this day, and for guidance during struggles we face, that God's light and glory would be revealed around us and among us, let us pray.
Have mercy, O God.
Merciful God, hear the prayers of your people, spoken or silent, for the sake of the one who dwells among us, your Son, Jesus Christ our Savior.
Amen.
Let us pray together as our Savior taught.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
During this traditional time of offering, we offer up our thanks for all who continue to support the ministries, and we also encourage you to feel emboldened in your own ministries as we seek to do this work amongst COVID. And the address for sending in offerings is in the announcements, and otherwise we will have a plate for you to put offerings in. For announcements, this Wednesday is a busy day. We have our Bible study at 9 in the morning that will be, of course, on Facebook. And then we have our Ash Wednesday worship services. Worship at our Savior's is at 5, and then we have worship at St. Olaf and here at 7 o'clock Wednesday evening. Then next Sunday we will be here at 10:30, so this will be the Facebook service. Again, we're doing this in person carefully, but we continue to live stream and do the FM transmitter if you want to park in the parking lot. The devotionals for Lent, A Story to Tell, are available. I think they may have all been taken. I think we ran out, and that is so awesome. I'm so happy. So we will be ordering some more so you can have that available to you. They're very, very excellent devotions to take you through Lent. And then our annual conference assembly is coming up. February 21st, it's at 2 p.m. on Zoom. If you are interested in taking part in this,